स्थापकाय च धर्मस्य सर्वधर्मस्वरूपिणे अवतारवरिष्ठाय रामकृष्णाय ते नमः। नमस्कार टू ऑल ऑफ यू, वेलकम टू द स्टडी ऑफ लाइफ ऑफ शारदानंद जी महाराज हु वाज़ द ऑथर ऑफ रामकृष्ण द ग्रेट मास्टर। The Bhagavad Gita says, he who finds action in inaction, and he who finds inaction in action, he is a perfect yogi. 4:18 of the Bhagavad Gita. Amidst the hectic surroundings and crowds, Sharadananda continued his serious writing project. One day, some young monks were talking loudly and laughing in the Udbodhan office, adjacent to the Swami's room. Golapma, an attendant of Holy Mother, scolded them, "Shame on you. Mother is upstairs and Sharat is doing serious work and you boys are making such great noise." Overhearing Golapma, her loud voice, now Swami Sharadananda said to her, "Well, Golapma, please don't give ears to them. It is the nature of these young boys to behave like that. I am so close to them, but I don't listen to what they are talking about. I have told my ears, don't listen to anything that is unnecessary. So my ears are not listening to them." Sharadananda had total control over his senses. There was one great person, a saint called Vilva Mangala. Earlier he was a debauchee, he was a sinner, he was a womanizer. So his story is told by Ramakrishna in Gospel, and also we hear the story from Swami Vivekananda too. His story is very similar to that of Tulsidas ji, Goswami Tulsidas ji. Earlier part of his life was very bad, then he gets transformed. So he had so much of attachment to a prostitute, so he was ready to go even on the day of the Shraddha ceremony of his father. So that prostitute transforms her by her single word, that you have so much of attachment towards this flesh and blood of mine, this body. If you had that same attachment towards God, then you would have realized God. So these words transform him, and from that day he changes to be a saint, Vilva Mangala. It's a long story, it is very interesting. But what happens is, once while he was walking on the river bank, immersed in the thought of his dear prostitute, so he was unaware of the external world. While walking, his leg, foot touched one of the saint who was meditating on the bank of the river. Then immediately the saint got angry and he came up, he pushed Vilva Mangala and told, "What kind of a man are you? I am sitting there and meditating upon God and you touch your feet to my body." Then Vilva Mangala questioned him, "What, you are meditating on God? I am thinking of that lowly prostitute and I am immersed, attached so much, I am not aware of the external world. While you call yourself you are meditating on God and you are aware that my leg, my feet touched your body, what kind of a meditation is it?" So now when we go into the meditation of God or thinking of God, so much should be our intense focus that the external world is absent to us, should be absent to us. So that is the intensity of meditation on God. If we really love God, then how can we be aware of the external world? So that's what you can see here. Sharadananda ji Maharaj has so much of control over his mind, and he is telling, at will he could control his mind. "Well, Golapma, please don't give your ears to them. It is the nature of these young boys to behave like that. I am so close to them, but I don't listen to what they are talking about. I have told my ears. So if he commands the ears not to do so, they will not do so. So everything is perfectly under his control. I have told my ears, don't listen to anything that is unnecessary. So my ears are not listening to them. So Sharadananda had total control over his senses. Indriya Nigraha. So in Sanskrit, in Samskrita, or in yogic parlance, or in Vedanta, it is called as Dama. Dama. Moreover, his life was extremely disciplined and he followed his routine strictly. Sharadanandaji Maharaj was always very much disciplined in his own personal life. Not ordinarily disciplined, but extremely disciplined. But when it comes to others, he would be very forgiving and he would not be stern on them. But when it comes to his own self, then he would be very disciplined and extremely strict on his personal life. That is the right approach. But on the contrary, what we general people do is, we'll be very liberal, compromising about our discipline and about our selfishness. But when it comes to others, we are so strict, we'll be finding fault and trying to discipline them always. So now Sharadanandaji Maharaj is showing the right path. Moreover, his life was extremely disciplined and he followed his routine very strictly. After having his morning bath, Sharadananda would go to the shrine and bow down to Sri Ramakrishna. And then he used to go to Holy Mother Sharada Devi, who was living there in Udbodhan, and then prostrate before her at 7 a.m. He would come downstairs and write for hours sitting in the same place, the life of Sri Ramakrishna. So he used to meditate, used to sit in one place and write the life of Sri Ramakrishna. He would come downstairs at 7 a.m. and write for hours sitting in the same place. He didn't even give time to stretch his body. As a result, in later years, the circulation in his legs was greatly impaired. And they could sometimes tremble. And the legs would sometimes tremble because of that. Always sitting in one posture for long hours for many, many years. In between his writing sessions, he would drink a cup of tea. He would have lunch at 1:30 p.m. And after that, he would rest for an hour. He wrote again until evening. And then he would meet the devotees. And sometimes he would go to Belur Math and stay there for a couple of days. In his memoirs, Swami Nikhilananda, the translator of Gospel of Sri Ramakrishna into English, Swami Nikhilananda wrote about an important incident. And what is that important incident? Before we left for Varanasi in 1925, Swami Shuddhananda asked Swami Sharadananda in front of me to finish the Kashipur chapter of the Leela Prasanga. Now, Swami Shuddhananda is asking Swami Sharadanandaji Maharaj, before they left to Varanasi in 1925, and Nikhilanandaji was there, to finish the Kashipur chapter of Leela Prasanga. because we see that after this January 1st incident, abruptly everything is stopped. That was in 1920, after the passing away of Holy Mother Sharda Devi, which would describe Sri Ramakrishna's last days. Now, Shardanandaji replied, he said that he had some notes, but he was not well enough to write the article. Swami Shuddhananda then said, you can dictate it and Nikhilananda will write it down. To which Shardanandaji replied, he would see what could be done. I believe he took his notebook with him. He did not feel well in Varanasi, so nothing was done. When we were leaving for Puri Jagannatha, Swami Shuddhananda reminded Shardananda about the article and asked him again to dictate the whole thing to him. Then, when insisted in this pattern, Swami Shardananda made the following significant remark. And what was that remark? When the revered Holy Mother Sharda Devi was alive, I felt a great deal of inner strength and began to write the Leela Prasanga, Ramakrishna the great master. She gave up her body and I felt as if all my powers were gone. Then I saw Swami Brahmananda and I began to feel strong again. When he too passed away, I felt as if my brain was completely paralyzed. I simply cannot finish this book. Then he added, when I began to write the Leela Prasanga, when I started writing this book, Ramakrishna the Great Master, I thought, I think from the house of Mother Sujata Chennarai, mic is on. Please, can you put off the mic? Mother Sujata Chennarai Patana. Om. Om Narayanaya. The mic of Sujata Chennarai Patana is on and the speaking is disturbing our class. Can you put off the microphone, please? Then Shardanandaji added, when I began to write the Leela Prasanga, that is the great master Sri Ramakrishna, I thought I understood the master, but now I clearly see that the life of Sri Ramakrishna is very, very deep. I was merely hovering over the top branches. The root is far beneath the ground. Neither Yam, that is Master Mahashay Mahendranath Gupta, nor Shardananda recorded the last days of Sri Ramakrishna, perhaps. It was not the will of Sri Ramakrishna. In 1925, when a disciple asked him to complete Sri Ramakrishna's life, Shardananda said humbly, perhaps it will never be completed. I am not getting any inspiration from within. The master made me write whatever he wanted, Now, when I read the Leela Prasanga, that is the Ramakrishna, the great master, I wonder, have I written all these things? Shardananda was so humble to tell that it is not me who I have written this, Ramakrishna, the great master, or the Leela Prasanga. The master made me write whatever he wanted. Now, when I read Sri Ramakrishna, the great master, that is Leela Prasanga, I wonder, have I written all these things? I have no more inclination to do anything. It seems that the master is doing everything. Sharadananda Ji Maharaj was an ideal karma yogi. What is or who is an ideal karma yogi? Who does real selfless work? The work is to be done, but we should not aspire for the result of the work, fruits of the work. Generally, you can see even from the animal to the baby, to the human beings or anybody, we work because we want to fulfill some desires. Yes, I get up and go to the dining hall or to the kitchen to cook the food because I have the desire to satiate my hunger. I go to the water and take it and drink it. The action of drinking the water is done because I have to quench my thirst. So I have a goal. I have a thing which I have to fulfill. So whatever work I do, or anybody for that sake, we get up or we act or we do to fulfill our desires. But Karma Yoga tells us, do not be attached to the result. Every work has to be done as an offering to the Lord without any attachment. We have to do the work. We cannot keep quiet. Even for a single moment, we cannot keep quiet. That is what Lord Krishna tells in Bhagavad Gita. Nahi kaschit kshanamapi jatu tishtatya karma akarma krit. Karyate yavashah karma prakriti jair gunaihi. So there Lord Krishna tells that you cannot even for a single moment keep quiet. You will be doing some work. So instead of doing all this work controlled by our guna, the nature, the samskaras, the desires, because of our likes and dislikes, we do all this work. Instead of that, if you now change your attitude and do it as a dedication to the God without aspiring for the selfish desires or fruit of action, so that state is called Karma Yoga. So by that you can purify your mind and you can reach the highest, that is God realization, to realize your true nature. Another aspect of this Karma Yoga is, as we told, you are not aspiring for the result of the action, or you are unattached to the work. You do the work as a dedication to the Lord. That is one aspect of this Karma Yoga. The other aspect of Karma Yoga is the highest state of Vedanta. What we have realized, what is Parabrahman, what is God, what is Atman, all that wonderful teachings of Vedanta, the truth, the reality, you try to bring into practice, make it useful in every aspect of your life, in every moment of your life. So bringing down that high truth to your action, to your day-to-day life, and making it fruitful. That is also another aspect of Karma Yoga. So here we can see Sharadanandaji Maharaj was a real Karma Yogi. A real Karma Yogi is always fearless and is not concerned about pleasing others. Why do we fear? When there are people other than me, so they will compete to what I desire for. So I get the fear, whatever I possess or I have gained, acquired, yoga kshema. Yoga is what I acquire. Kshema is to preserve that, whatever I have acquired in the form of wealth or anything, things or people. So when I see that somebody is competing with me to take away that which I have acquired, my property, my things, then I get the fear. Because of that fear, I get the anger, the jealousies and other things. So we try to act selfishly, harm others or trouble others. So all the sinful activities start. So a Karma Yogi is always fearless because he's not at all bothered about the result of the work. He's not attached to the work. His only aim is to please the Lord, Bhagavat Prityarthe. He will not be trying to please the human beings. So he's not concerned about what the other people think about him. So a real Karma Yogi is always fearless. If we have fear, that means we don't have faith in God. If we have fear, that means we don't have the faith in the protecting hands of God or the existence of God. But we have more faith in the existence of devil, demons, hobgoblins and so many other things. We are afraid even to go to the darkness, but we are not at all fearless, thinking that God is always protecting me. So a Karma Yogi who always tries to please the Lord is fearless and is not concerned about what others think of him or what is the view of others. He is always trying to please the Lord. And he is not concerned about others' criticism. Because when we are bothered about others' criticism, what will others tell about me, then my actions, my behavior, my nature in the external world will start changing. I'll become a hypocrite. In reality, I'm somebody. Then to please others and to stop the criticism of others, I go on changing my pattern of life. So I'm always concerned about others' criticism whenever I work. But a real Karma Yogi works for God and depends on his will. As the Karma Yogi has no selfish motives, he cannot be affected. The Karma Yogi cannot be affected by the praise or blame. Whether somebody will praise him, or when somebody praises us, we rise up to the sky, we get bloated up. And if somebody criticizes us, as if that balloon which started bloating due to the praise, so if somebody criticizes, then it is just like the pinprick to the balloon and it will blast and I go down. So I get to depression. If somebody praises, I get to excitement. So I get affected. Extremes, I go to the other extremes. But a Karma Yogi has no selfish motives. He cannot be affected by praise or blame. Whether somebody praises him or whether somebody blames him, he's not bothered. His only focus is on how to please the Lord. Lord Krishna said in the Bhagavad Gita, they are wretched. Those people are wretched or lowly who seek the result of their actions. And also in another place, Lord Krishna tells in Bhagavad Gita, Karmanyevadhikaraste mafaleshu kadachana. You have the right to work and not to the fruits thereof. So here Lord Krishna tells, they are wretched they are lowly, who seek the result of their actions. Why are they wretched? Why are they lowly? It is the nature of the animals. The brutal tendencies, we are controlled by the hormones, we are controlled by the impulses, we are controlled by the likes and dislikes. So just some milligrams of some hormones, pituitary, adrenaline, estrogen, testosterone. So these hormones in such small quantity, they are dead, insentient chemicals. They control our thoughts. They control our nature, our behavior. We are of the nature of Parabrahma Swarupa, infinite strength, infinite bliss, infinite existence, infinite beings. And to be controlled by these millionth of a gram of some hormones, is it not a shame? Should we be controlled by the insentient thing, dead matter, or should we control them? Should the dog wag the tail or the tail wag the dog? Now the tail is wagging the dog. They are controlling us. So we behave according to these hormones, impulses, instincts, just like the animals. Whenever it gets some smell of some eatable, the dog or the wolf, they get up and run towards that. They cannot withstand, they cannot control. But we human beings have the capacity of discrimination, viveka, to understand, to decide what is good, what is bad, what is right, what is wrong, what is real, what is unreal. The animals, at least, they don't have it. After having all these faculties, the capacity to think, the capacity to realize the highest, your true nature, if we are using this human life for just fulfilling our puny desires and enjoying the sensual things, so that's why Lord Krishna is telling, they are wretched and lowly who seek only the result of their actions. Sharadananda was a role model for leading balanced life. His character was perfect blend of the four yogas. So what is the quickest way of progressing in spiritual life? If you take up only bhakti and go forward to reach God, you become fanatical. You become one-sided, lopsided. If you take up only jnana, the knowledge aspect of God, and try to realize God, then you become dry. You will be very broad, but there will be no depth. In bhakti, there will be depth, there will be no breadth. So, combination, harmonious combination, harmony, symphony, balance in yogas, that is what Swami Vivekananda has given, and that is what Ramakrishna Paramahamsa used to tell. Jnana Mishrita Bhakti, Karma Yoga, Jnana Yoga, Raja Yoga, Bhakti Yoga have to be very nicely, harmoniously combined in our life. And that is the right path for sure, or fast progress in spiritual life. So here, Sharadananda was a role model for leading a balanced life. His character was a perfect blend of all four yogas. He was a jnani, man of wisdom. Everybody, every person, irrespective of what they are, whichever color, whichever creed, whichever birth, or whichever country, everybody, every human being has the faculty in his brain or mind, the rational faculty, the logical faculty. And that will help you to go forward in the Jnana Marga. Then there will be the emotional faculty, sentimental nature. So using that and going forward in spiritual life, that is the Bhakti Marga. using up the sentiments and the feelings of your heart, then you have the capacity to analyze your mind, think of your mind, meditate, contemplate. That is the aspect of Raja Yoga. Everybody will have this capacity, but something may be dormant, something may be manifested. Then your restless nature, active always, extrovert nature. So that aspect is useful for Karma Yoga. So everybody has all these four aspects, but your nature or your last life or your tendencies or your upbringing might propel you to take up only one part and develop one side, one aspect of it, which may also have some side effects. But when you combine them very harmoniously, all four of them, then the progress will be very good and the defects can be taken out. The defect of Bhakti Yoga, which brings in fanaticism, sectarianism, can be overcome by the Jnana Marga, the breadth, the broadness of Jnana Marga. Then the analytical faculty of Raja Yoga can bring out the defects in our mind and clear it off. Karma Yoga can take us very quickly doing the selfless work towards the goal to exhaust our karma. So in this way, very nicely, we have to combine all the four yogas. Sharadananda's character was a perfect blend of the four yogas. So holistic development of that personality is the fullest manifestation of Parabrahma Swarupa. Sharadananda was a Jnani, man of wisdom, and attained Nirvikalpa Samadhi. His devotion to his Ishtadevata, that is Master Ramakrishna, the Mother Sharada Devi, and Swami Vivekananda was profound. And he was a perfect contemplator, yogi, Raja Yoga. Even 1,000 problems could not perturb the equanimity of his mind. He could control his mind perfectly, which is the aim of Raja Yoga. And he was an ideal worker, selfless worker, Karma Yogi, who offered his body and mind and soul to carry out Sri Ramakrishna's mission. Once Holy Mother Sharada Devi said to one of her disciples, "Look at Sharat, that is Sharadananda. Look at Sharat, he works so much, he faces so many problems, yet he remains calm. And you see some people, they do very little work, but they shout, fret and fume and so much of noise, so much of sound, sizzling, disturbing others and showing off as if they are doing so much of work. But whatever on the field, the work will be very less. I will be teasing some of our people here. We are all tigers and lions on the paper. In the meeting, and when people are there, oof, we talk so much. But when it comes to action, execution, it is very minimal, very slow, very low, very procrastinating. But on the paper, in the meeting, oof, we talk so much, we tell, we will do that, we will do this. And at the end of the year, when we go back and read out all those things which we have recorded in the meeting, then we see very little has been done. So we are tigers and lions on the paper, but when it comes to action, we are nobodies. But here you can see Holy Mother is praising Sharadanandaji Maharaj. Look at Sharat. He works so much, he faces so many problems, yet he remains calm and never complains. He is a true sadhu, holy man. Why does he undergo all these things? If he wishes, he can remain absorbed in God, contemplation, just meditation of God. He need not do all this work at all. He can be absorbed day and night in God. Then why is he working so much? It is pure unselfishness. It is only for the good of others, to the good of humanity. It is only for your good that he is living in this earthly plane. Another time, Swami Vivekananda said, what is the comment of Swami Vivekananda about Sharadananda? The master Sri Ramakrishna bought Sharat, that is Sharadananda, for his work. As the general secretary of Ramakrishna order, Sharadananda had to face problems after problems because it's a pioneering work. After the organization is built, it's very easy to maintain it. Everything is in its place. But pioneering work, when you begin from scratch, from zero, and to build up an organization, is a very tough task. And Sharadananda had to do that. As the general secretary of the Ramakrishna order, Sharadananda had to face problems after problems. And Sharadananda was a very well-known troubleshooter. Most of us are troublemakers, but Sharadananda was a troubleshooter. When I was looking after the students, adolescent students, in Ramakrishna Vidyarthi Mandiram, the restless boys, the adolescent boys, couldn't stay in their rooms for more than half an hour or 1 hour. They want to get up, go here and there. Restlessness. They want to talk, chit-chat. And I will be monitoring. Nobody can come out and go there. They have to study. So they will come slowly to me, Swamiji. I have to solve some problems. So I'll go and take the help of my friend. Then I used to comment on that. Do you want to solve problems or create problems? The solving of the problem is only an excuse. They will catch hold of a book and they will tell that you want to solve some mathematical problems, but I would be intelligent to open his book. It would be some chemistry book or some other book, subject book. So then the moment they see that I'm going to catch hold of them, they are chit-chatting, they will open some books. And if I go and take the book will not be concerned with the subject at all. So I used to ask them, are you going to solve the problems of the mathematics or create some new problems? So like that here, Sharadanandaji was always, when other people used to create problem, or the external nature would bring so many difficult problems to the organization, he was a troubleshooter. Whatever might be the problem, he could solve it in a trice. So Swami Sharadananda was called as a wonderful troubleshooter. In 1909, Devabrata Basu and Sachindranath Sen, two young revolutionaries. Who were revolutionaries? When British were ruling India, Indian freedom movement took two paths. One was fighting the British through non-cooperation, through peace, and the other was fighting through the arms and ammunition and throwing them out. They were called revolutionaries. So they would take up arms and ammunition and fight the British for bullet to bullet, for tit for tat. So they used to fight. They were called revolutionaries in India. So here, this in 1909, Devabrata Basu and Sachindranath Sen, there were two young revolutionaries who were fighting against the British with arms. They were fighting to free India from the clutches of the British rule. They were convicted in Manikand Maniktala bomb case. But later on, they were found not guilty and released by the court. Then they joined the Ramakrishna order to become sannyasins, took initiation from Holy Mother Sharda Devi, and after their final vows, they became Swami Prajnananda and Chinmayananda. Swami Atma Prakashananda and Satyananda had also been revolutionaries. So many revolutionaries were fighting the British with arms and ammunition. They had got transformed by the touch of many direct disciples, by the company of great souls, by coming into contact with Holy Mother Sharda Devi, Shardanandaji Maharaj, Premanandaji Maharaj, by their wonderful love and affection. They gave up that Himsa Pravritti, fighting with bombs and guns and ammunition and killing the British, and they turned their life towards God realization. Many, many revolutionaries were there, freedom fighters were there in the organization at that time. To accept them into the order to the Ramakrishna Sangha, to give them place in the ashrama, was to invite the wrath and suspicion of the British government and the police. But to refuse admission to sincere spiritual aspirant simply because of their past conduct would be sheer cowardice. Shardananda, as the general secretary, accepted them all and boldly faced the police, the British police and the government of that period. You know that the British were all powerful, dictatorial. It was not democracy, it was one-sided. Whatever they tell, whatever they do was the final thing. Although the Ramakrishna order has never involved itself in politics, which is the rules done by Swami Vivekananda, that Ramakrishna order monks should never take active role in politics. The presence of the former revolutionaries brought police surveillance upon the order. So the police would always send the spies and surveillance to see what is going on in the order. Are they planning something against the British? When Atma Prakashananda joined the Udbodhan Center in 1912, the police learned about that he was a revolutionary earlier. Now he has joined the order, is in the Udbodhan. And that's why they summoned Shardananda. Now, if any problem happens in the organization, the head of the organization is taken to task. It may be some member of the organization doing some trouble, but the blame goes to the head of the organization. So now the police summoned Shardananda and Atma Prakashananda for questioning to the police station. The police official did not even offer a chair to Shardananda, nor did the police official speak courteously to that senior direct disciple who was a realized soul, Shardananda. But whatever might be the situation, whether it is blame or praise, whether it is insult or reward, the Jnani, the Brahma Jnani, the Karma Yogi or the realized soul will not be affected by that, because he identifies not with the ego. When we identify with our ego, we are disturbed by these insults. But a realized soul or a Karma Yogi, because he identifies with God, is not at all troubled by these insults. So the police official did not even offer a chair for the senior. You know, Shardanandaji by that time was very old and senior. And the police official would not even speak courteously to that senior monk. But whatever might be his behavior, Sharadananda Ji Maharaj was very courteous, and withstood all that insults very calmly. As we have told, titiksha sahanam sarvadukkhanam apratikara purvakam chinta vilaparahitam sa titiksha nigadhyate. He had that perfect control, titiksha. Now, when that police official was very non-courteous and insulting, in spite of that, Sharadananda gently assured the police official that the young men who have joined the order had given up all political activities, so no harm will come to the British rule. While returning to the monastery, Atma Prakashananda, because of whom this great senior monk, the realized soul, the direct disciple, Sharadananda, was insulted, because of him. It was no mistake of Sharadananda at all. Or rather, it was not even the mistake of Atma Prakashananda. He had given up all political activities. Now, Atma Prakashananda said in an aggrieved tone, Swamiji, that is addressing Swami Sharadananda, is telling Swamiji, I am extremely sorry. It is for my sake that you had to put up with an insult unworthy of your position. To which Sharadananda Ji Maharaj smilingly replied, who can insult me? Nobody can insult me. Who can insult me? Sharadananda replied, if my mind does not accept the rudeness, how can I be insulted? Have I kept anything for myself? I don't have my ego at all. I always work for God. It is only God and God within me. There is no ego. So if ego is there, then you get hurt. Anybody's rudeness. Have I anything for myself? Have I kept anything for myself? This whole body, mind, my soul is for God. Nothing is there for myself. So then where is the question of insult? If my mind does not accept the rudeness, how can I be insulted? Have I kept anything for myself? I have already offered my body, mind and soul at the blessed feet of our Lord Ramakrishna, where there cannot be any room for good or bad, honor and dishonor. Be at ease. You need not worry on my behalf at all. Nobody can insult me. I will never take insult. The external world cannot disturb me at all. We can now notice one of the incidents from the life of Lord Buddha. Once when Lord Buddha went to beg for alms, one of the owners of the house who came to give him the alms saw Buddha. He didn't like Buddha. He was very angry about Buddha. So he started criticizing him, scolding him, insulting him instead of giving him alms. Very calmly, Buddha forbore all those things with a smile on his face. When that person, the owner of the house, got exhausted of scolding and insulting Buddha, and he was tired and he could speak no more, then Lord Buddha asked that person with a gentle smile, sir, have you finished your scolding? Yes, I have nothing more to tell. Now I have a question to you, sir. What is that? Suppose you had given this alms to me and I would have accepted it. Whom does the alms or that food which you have given belongs to? To you. Suppose you have given the alms, I begged for food and you give me the food, the alms, and I don't accept it. Whom does that food belong to, that alms belong to? To me. Then immediately Buddha, with a smile, gentle smile, replied, I have not accepted whatever you have given me in the form of criticism or scoldings. And Buddha, with a smile, walked away. He himself was caught in the muddle. He asked him the question, suppose you had given me the alms and I had accepted it, whom does that belong to? To you. Suppose you have given the alms and I don't accept it, whom does that alms belong to? To me. Then whatever you have given now in the form of scolding and insult, I have not accepted it. Whom does that belong to? To you. The person who has scolded, he told that and went away. So if you don't accept it, it doesn't belong to you. When people scold you, insult you, criticize you, if you accept it, then only all the problems start. If you don't accept it, then it belongs to the person who has scolded. What a lesson taught from Lord Buddha. And see, this very same thing is being followed by Sharada Anandaji Maharaj. Nobody can insult me. Who can insult me? Who can insult me? Shardananda replied, if my mind does not accept the rudeness, how can I be insulted? Have I kept anything for myself? I have already offered my body, mind and soul at the blessed feet of my Lord Ramakrishna, where there cannot be any room for good and bad, honor and dishonor, be at ease. You need not worry on my behalf. When Swami Vivekananda was giving a lecture in America about high Vedanta, one British officer who was working in India, who hated India and Indians, was one of the audience. In between, he stood up and started abusing Swami Vivekananda vehemently in a bad manner. He stopped the lecture and he started insulting him. Vivekananda just smiled at him and kept quiet. So he scolded and criticized and talked all nonsense. All the audience were spellbound. Vivekananda was just smiling. He was in a very high state of mood. He was talking about the highest Vedantic truths of Parabrahma. And here he is scolding and insulting him with all the rudeness. And Vivekananda is smiling at him. Then after he got exhausted and went away, then Vivekananda very calmly continued his lecture as if nothing has happened. He was not at all disturbed, even a little. And after the lecture, the devotees, the Western devotees came to him and asked, Swamiji, at least you could have defended yourself. You would have not committed any mistake. You have not done anything and he is insulting you, he is scolding you, you could have at least defended yourself. Then Swami Vivekananda replied, I was in such a high state of mind, I was thinking of the Lord, the highest Nirakar Nirguna Parabrahma, the Atma Swarupa, Parabrahma Swarupa. I couldn't understand, was he scolding and who was he scolding? And who is getting that scolding? I couldn't know the difference at all. Because I was seeing the Lord, the Atman, the Parabrahma Swarupa consciousness everywhere. I couldn't know the difference at all between who was scolding whom and who was receiving the scolding and what is that scolding. Even that scolding is seen as Parabrahma. Just like in Brahmarpanam, you tell Brahmarpanam Brahma Havihi Brahmagnau Brahmanahutam Brahmaivatena Gantavyam Brahma Karma Samadhina. In the Yaga, in the Yajna, in the sacrifice, the fire is God. The oblation is God. The ladle with which the oblation is offered is God. The act of oblation is God. The person who is offering is God. And the result you are going to get out of that oblation is God. There is nothing but in God, God and God alone. That is the higher state, which is told by Lord Krishna in Bhagavad Gita in the 4th chapter, 24th verse. So now Swami Vivekananda, while giving that lecture on the Parabrahma Swarupa, on that highest Lord of Vedanta, is in such a high state, he cannot know the difference at all. Did he scold? Was he scolding? Whom was he scolding? Was it scolding? So he was in such a high state that he couldn't even differentiate. So I couldn't understand who was scolding whom and who was receiving the scolding. I couldn't know the difference at all. Vivekananda was in such a high state, so he was just smiling. So here too, you can see Sharadanandaji Maharaj is telling, be at ease, you need not worry on my behalf at all. I have offered my body, mind and soul at the blessed feet of our Lord Ramakrishna. Where there cannot be any room for good and bad, honor and dishonor. Nobody can insult me until I accept it. If I don't accept it, how can anybody insult? So it is in our hand. It is with us. If we accept it, then only we are troubled. If we don't accept it, then nobody can trouble us. The world cannot touch us at all. The problems of the order went on increasing. It continued. Most of the revolutionaries had been inspired by the patriotic lectures and writings of Swami Vivekananda. At that time, Vivekananda was not anymore, but the works, especially the Colombo to Almora, in the complete works, there is a section called Swami Vivekananda's complete works. We have a section called Colombo to Almora. The lectures given by Swami Vivekananda when he came back to India from America, he visited Colombo in the ship, and from Colombo to Sri Lanka, he went by horse carriage and other vehicles. He came to Tamil Nadu, Ramanathapuram, and from there he went from place to place and he reached Almora. Until then, wherever he went, he was given rousing reception because of his success in Parliament of Religion, and he used to give talk on the way everywhere. Such wonderful talk of patriotism. Anybody who reads that talk of Swami Vivekananda, his nationalism, his love to the country will increase thousand folds. So now, hearing his lecture, fairy lecture, from Colombo to Almora, all these people, the young people of India at that time, were inspired by that, and their nationalism, the love for the country increased. So they took up arms against the British and started fighting. So each revolutionary who used to fight against Swami Vivekananda, against the British, whenever they were arrested and they were taken to be hanged or punished, they would have two copies of books. What were that two copies? One is Bhagavad Gita and another is Colombo to Almora, Swami Vivekananda's teachings. Even they used to go to the gallows, to the deathbed, when they were to be hanged. Because they were revolutionaries, they were fighting against the British with arms and ammunition. When they were put to the gallows, they would be smiling. They would not be afraid or crying for life. They would be smiling. They would be laughing. So looking at that, the British were dumbfounded. When they searched, they used to be having these two books, Bhagavad Gita and Colombo to Almora of Swami Vivekananda. So then the British started thinking that Swami Vivekananda was conspiring against the British Empire in India, because almost all the freedom fighters were inspired by Swami Vivekananda. So the problems continued for the Ramakrishna order, because most of the revolutionaries had been inspired by the patriotic. Most of the freedom fighters were inspired by the patriotic lectures and writings of Vivekananda. When they were arrested, the police found Swami Vivekananda's book in their homes. So the British government was very upset about the publication of Ramakrishna Mission. In Dhaka on 11th December 1916, Lord Carmichael, the governor of Bengal, made some damaging remarks during the Darbar speech about Ramakrishna Mission, which had a devastating effect on its activities. The general public became afraid of supporting the mission as a fear that they might be tortured or harassed by the government. Moreover, the British government had the full power to curb the philanthropic activities of the mission. They would not allow permission for doing any work or hospital, running the hospital or the school, or doing any philanthropic work or the social service would not be allowed because it was the dictatorial rule. Nobody could stop the British. During this crisis, Sharadananda, who was the head, the executive head, this general secretary, stood calmly at the helm of the Ramakrishna mission, wishing to remove this doubt and misunderstanding. On 23rd January 1917, Sharadananda wrote a memorandum containing 12 points to Lord Carmichael. On 2nd March, Mr. Gourlay, the governor's secretary, and Mr. Denham, the police chief, they came to Belur Math to meet with the general secretary, Swami Sharadananda. When Sharadananda wrote a memorandum to them, they came, all of them. On 10th March, Sharadananda was invited to the governor's house, where he talked with Lord Carmichael for an hour. On 26th March, the governor withdrew his statement, and a rare event during the British rule in India. The letter he wrote to Sharadananda is as follows. Dear sir, just by that 1 hour meeting of Swami Sharadananda, change the attitude of this governor of the British, Carmichael, in such a way that he writes a letter, he withdrew his statement, the damaging statement against the Ramakrishna mission. Not only that, not only he withdrew the statement, he wrote a letter. And what is that letter? Dear sir, I thank you for having come to see me and for the trouble you have taken to tell me about the origin of the Ramakrishna mission and its aim and objects. I read with great interest the memorial which the mission authorities submitted to me some time ago. I regret very much to hear that words used by me at the Darbar in December last regarding the mission should have led in any way to the curtailment of the good religious, social, educational work the mission has done and is doing. As you, I know, realize my object was not to condemn the Ramakrishna mission and its members. I know the character of the mission's work is entirely non-political, and I have heard nothing but good of its work of social service for the people. What I wanted to impress upon the public is this: charitable and philanthropic works such as the mission undertake is being adopted deliberately by a section of the Revolutionary Party as a cloak for their own nefarious schemes, and in order to attract to their organization's youths who are animated by ideals such as those which actuate the mission, with the intention of perverting these ideals to their own purposes. And with this object, unscrupulous use it is being made of the name and reputation of the Ramakrishna mission. I have full sympathy with the real aim of the true Ramakrishna mission, and it was this abuse of the name of the mission I wish to prevent. I hope the words I used will help the mission to guard against the illegitimate use of its name by unscrupulous people. Yours very sincerely, Carmichael. When this letter was published in the newspapers, the cloud of misunderstanding and the public's fear dissipated. The police surveillance was also withdrawn. In 1919, Lord Ronald Shai, the new governor of Bengal, came to visit Belur Math. Sharadananda cordially received him, and with all humility, you know, is a realized soul. You know how they treat monks, and that too a realized soul in India. They are ready to do any service, menial service, to that person. But here is Sharadananda, who is such a senior monk, is the general secretary of the whole order, is the direct disciple of Ramakrishna. Ramakrishna revered him. Holy Mother Sharda Devi respected him. Vivekananda praised him to the skies. And he has realized the Parabrahman, the highest Godhead. And see the nature of Sharadananda. When this governor in 1919, Lord Ronald Shai, the new governor of Bengal, came to visit the Blue Mutt, Sharadananda cordially received him, and with all humility, you know, what was the service done by Sharadananda? He untied the shoes of this governor before taking him to the shrine. Sharadananda bent down himself. He was very senior. He was very old. He's a direct disciple. He was a general secretary. Is he a realized soul? But no ego at all. Zero ego. For the sake of the order, for the sake of the Lord, he is ready to do any menial work. He bowed down, he knelt down in front of that governor. He's so young in age and is an ordinary person, but only the position is a governor's post, that's all. What does he know about the greatness of Sharadananda, who was such a great soul? Now, Sharadananda bent down, knelt down and untied the shoes, helping him to remove the shoes before entering into the shrine. He took him to the shrine. With all humility, Sharadananda untied his shoes before taking him to the shrine. The governor expressed his gratitude and learned from Sharadananda about the history and activities of Ramakrishna Mission. Whenever any distinguished guest or foreign visitor came to visit Belur Mutt, Sharadananda would go from Udbodhan, Calcutta, to receive them. Anybody coming to Belur Mutt, distinguished guest, foreign visitors, Sharadananda was in Udbodhan. He would give up all the work, would go from Udbodhan, from Calcutta, to receive them. Although Brahmananda had a gigantic spiritual personality, when these important visitors came, he became nervous like a child. In 1911, Madame Emma Calvey, the famous French opera singer and a devotee of Swami Vivekananda, visited Belur Mutt. Emma Calvey had a lot of personal problems. She wanted to commit suicide. After meeting Swami Vivekananda, it changed her life. And she started doing spiritual practices and rose up very high. Her mind became very strong. She owed her life to Swami Vivekananda. So that Madam Emma Calvey, the famous French opera singer, was an ardent devotee of Swami Vivekananda, in 1911 visited Belur Mutt. Sharadananda cordially received her and introduced her to Brahmananda. Calvey came with an interpreter because she did not know English. She knew only French. She did not know English well. Sharadananda first took her to the small shrine built in memory of Swami Vivekananda on the actual spot where Swami Vivekananda's body has been cremated. Madam Emma Calvey, she sat down in meditation posture and prayed before the engraved emblem of Swami Vivekananda. Sharadananda then escorted her to Sri Ramakrishna's shrine. She knelt down before the image of Sri Ramakrishna and paid her respect. Madam Emma Calvey said to Sharadananda, "Swami Vivekananda used to repeat a nice chant that starts with, 'Lead us from darkness to light.' And what is that Sanskrit chant, the mantra? असतो मा सद्गमया तमसो मा ज्योतिर्गमया मृत्योर मा अमृतंगमया ओम शांति 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 ही दैट वुड बी चैंटेड बाय स्वामी विवेकानंद ड्यूरिंग हिज लेक्चर्स और अदर पीरियड विद ग्रेट मेलोडियस टोन स्वामी विवेकानंद यूज्ड टू चैंट दैट सो शी रिमेंबर्ड द आर्डेंट डिवोटी द फ्रेंच ओपेरा सिंगर मैडम एमा काल्वे शी रिमेंबर्ड दैट After paying respect to Sri Ramakrishna in the shrine, Kalbe said to Sharadananda, Swami Vivekananda used to repeat a nice chant that starts with, Lead us from darkness to light, Asatoma Satgamaya Tamasoma Jyotirgamaya. Would you kindly repeat the whole chant? If you know it, I am eager to hear it. Immediately, Sharadananda chanted with his sweet, melodious voice, Asatoma Sadgamaya Tamasoma Jyotirgamaya Mrityorma Amritangamaya Avir Avir Maedhi. Lead us from the unreal to the real. Lead us from the darkness to the light. Lead us from death to immortality. Lead us through and through. When she was about to leave the shrine, the householder disciple of Swami Vivekananda, Sharad Chandra Chakravarti, disciple of Swami Vivekananda, because that Emma Kalbe was an opera singer, French opera singer, asked or requested Emma Kalbe to sing a song in French as an offering to Sri Ramakrishna in the shrine. Asked her to sing a song as an offering to Master. Gladly, Kalbe accepted it and sang a song in French. A magnificent voice charged the atmosphere with joy and beauty. After she left, Sharadananda made a comment. Look at the influence of Swami Vivekananda. Living in affluence and luxury, still she could not forget Swami Vivekananda. She is living in so much of luxury and affluence, and she has so much name and fame all over the world. And in France, she is worshipped as a goddess, the French opera singer. She is famous all over the world, but yet see the influence of Swami Vivekananda. Just one or two meetings, how much her life is changed, so much of devotion to Swami Vivekananda. Look at the influence of Swami Vivekananda. Living in affluence and luxury, still she could not forget him. Miss Laura Glenn, later who became Sister Deva Mata, an American devotee of Swami Vivekananda, had not been able to see Sharadananda in America. However, when she came to India, when she moved permanently to India, she met Swami Sharadananda at Udbodhan office. She wrote in her memoirs about Sharadananda. I saw at once why he had called for so much love wherever he went in the West. Sharadananda was very much loved by everybody in America. Devamata or this Laura Glenn couldn't meet Sharadananda in America, but he was very popular as a loving monk and such a great soul. All people in America and other places respected Sharadananda for his loving behavior. Now she writes, I saw at once when I met Sharadananda, why? He had called for so much of love in the West, wherever he went in the West. He seemed, that is Sharadananda, seemed to possess an exalted gentleness, a graciousness and courtesy which made a direct appeal to everyone. He was the highest breeding of all, the breeding not merely of manner or of culture, but of the spirit. It was the outgrowth of the divine rather than of human relationship. His life was lived in a little room across the hall from Udbodhan office. In the far inner corner of that room, beside a long open window opening on a central court, he sat cross-legged with a small writing desk in front of him. Hour after hour, he wrote articles for the magazine, a book of his own, official letters or letters to friends. He was always a generous correspondent. Visitors came and he would lay down his pen or pencil only to pick it up again as soon as they were gone. When daylight dimmed and the lamps were bought, the little desk was pushed to one side, the pen and pencil and thought grew still in meditation. So Miss Laura Glenn, later who became Sister Devamata, writes, "Father, I did not see Swami Sharadananda during the closing years of his life, but letters from him and from other Swamis of the order kept me in touch with him. And I could discern from what was written how gradually he was drawing away from the outer world into his innermost being. As the days went by, fewer and fewer were the hours given to the earthly tasks. More and more were the hours devoted to super earthly communion, until his life became unbroken meditation and he was gone. No disciple ever served his master's cause with greater fervor and steadfastness than Sharadananda did. Once Swami Pavitrananda talked to Sharadananda about a conflict regarding work. Swamiji, I work, but I don't feel that I'm working for the master. I have a conflict." Everybody will naturally have this conflict. Karma Yoga tells that we should work for God, but I'm working here. Swami Pavitrananda talked to Sharadananda about a conflict regarding Karma Yoga or work. Swamiji, I work, but don't feel that I'm working for Sri Ramakrishna. To which Sharadananda calmly replied, "Don't you think that it is not your work?" "Yes, I do. It's not my work. I'm just following your order. I do whatever you have asked me to do. That's enough. If you know that it is not your work, that's enough. It's not for your ego, that's enough." He replied, Swami Nikhilananda recalled, "I am active by nature." That is, Swami Nikhilananda was active by nature. He is recalling his memory of Sharadananda. "One day Sharadananda said to me, 'It is good to be active, but it depends on several factors. Your health must be good and you must be able to get along with fellow workers. But suppose you have injured one of your limbs, then it would be difficult for you to work. Therefore, I request you to cultivate a habit of reading the scriptural books. Swadhyaya is very, very important. You are active, I can understand. How much can you work? Suppose you are injured, you are sick, then you cannot work. So you should also develop the habit of reading Swadhyaya, scriptures. Therefore, Sharadananda is telling Nikhilananda, 'Yes, you are very active. I can understand that. Your health must be for that. It depends upon several factors. Your health must be good and you must be able to get along with the fellow workers. But suppose you have injured one of your limbs, then it would be difficult for you to work. Therefore, I request you to cultivate the habit of reading. Even that is not enough. The higher habit of reading, that itself in itself is not enough. Even that is not enough. Suppose you become blind, then you cannot read. Therefore, it is good that you should also practice meditation and japa, so that if you cannot read, if you cannot work, even if you become incapable of doing anything, or in old age you cannot see anything, at least you can still meditate. That's why to go on cultivating the higher and higher habits. How many days can you work? So always cultivate the habit of reading Swadhyaya, scriptures, Bhagavad Gita, Upanishads, Ramayana, Mahabharata. Cultivate these good habits. That also is wonderful, but when in old age if you lose your eyesight, you cannot read, then what will you do? So still higher habit of meditation, japa, that will help you. Even if you have lost your eyesight, even if you cannot work, still you can meditate. So that is the way Swami Shardananda would guide the monks. The secrets of Shardananda's great success in his active life were his humility. What is humility? Absence of ego. And also his respect for human dignity of others. In 1918, Umananda wrote from Vrindavan to tell Shardananda that he was coming to Calcutta to see him. But the letter was somehow misplaced. When Umananda arrived, Shardananda reprimanded the younger monk for leaving the center without previously writing to him. And although Umananda said that he had written the letter, the Swami did not believe in him. Later, when Shardananda discovered the misplaced letter, he tearfully regretted his conduct. He approached Brahmananda, then president, with a request that he should be relieved of the secretaryship of the order. He wanted to resign from the secretaryship because of that small mistake of his. Shardananda told him the whole story and lamented. He was right. I scolded him without reason. I must send for him and beg his forgiveness. Brahmananda asked him not to go so far, but Shardananda could not rest until he actually apologized to the monk for his mistake and begged for his forgiveness. So that was the humility, that was the great nature. Even a small mistake of his, he wanted to resign from the secretaryship itself. And until he apologized to that younger monk for his mistake, he couldn't rest. He cried. He shed tears for that mistake. I have scolded that monk for no reason of his. When Umananda arrived, even though he had written the letter, it was misplaced. Shardananda reprimanded the younger monk for leaving the center without previously writing to him. And although Umananda said that he had written the letter, the Swami did not believe him. Later, when Shardananda discovered the letter, should note that he tearfully regretted his conduct. He could have ignored it. He was a general secretary, he was a great soul. It was ordinary scolding. But he couldn't. He tearfully regretted his conduct. He approached Brahmananda, the then president, with the request that he should be relieved of the secretaryship of the order. He wanted to resign. Shardananda told him the whole story and lamented. He was right. I scolded him without reason. I must send for him and beg for his forgiveness. Brahmananda asked him not to go so far, but Shardananda could not rest until he actually apologized to that young monk for his mistake and begged his forgiveness. That was the humility of Shardananda, and not only his humility and his respect for the human dignity of others. So these are the real qualities of a leader. Leadership qualities. Many people will be asking, please tell about leadership quality. You can see it here. Sharadananda knew human nature very well. Those monks who were unbalanced or who had been rejected by the other centers, they would be given shelter with Sharadananda, because Sharadananda was so loving. Any unbalanced or any bad-tempered monk, he could handle them because of his loving nature. Many monks who were rejected by many centers would get shelter with Sharadananda. People who were unwanted by all would be taken care of by Sharadananda. Such was his broad heart. In Udbodhan, people, such monks would take shelter in Udbodhan with Holy Mother Sharada Devi and Sharadananda. Swami Sharadananda adopted three basic methods to make these monks work. Even such monks who were not controllable, who had bad temper, who were rejected by other centers, who were well known for their unbalanced nature. Now, Swami Sharadananda had adopted three basic methods to make these monks work. First of all, he gave them freedom. He put his trust, belief in them. Not all these things which we can adopt. Anybody wants to become a leader at the helm of the affair of any organization, or even in the house, if you can adopt these things, you can easily run the family, the organization, or the workplace. So Swami Sharadananda adopted these three basic methods to make such uncontrollable people. Firstly, he gave them freedom and put his trust in them. And finally, he poured his love and affection on them. He was a ajata shatru. What is meant by ajata shatru? Ajata means unborn. Shatru means enemy. So to such a person, the enemy is unborn. There can never be any enemies to him. So such people are called ajata shatru. Ajata means, jata means born. Ajata means not born. So the enemies are not born at all to such people. Such is the large heartedness, such is the love they pour, that there will be no enemy to them at all. They are not at all born. So he was a ajata shatru, a person whose enemy has never been born. In 1919, the head of his center had a problem with his monastic workers. And Sharadananda wrote to him. What was that letter? How to handle? Each soul is eternally free. So each person desires to be free in every respect of his life. See, again, you can see in this letter, the quality of a leadership, quality of a leader is given. A real leader never obstructs others' freedom. Rather, he teaches how one should enjoy freedom properly, even in the field of action. So I will read this letter again. 1919, when the head of a center had problem with his monastic workers, Sharadananda wrote a letter to that head of the center. Each soul is eternally free. So each person desires to be free in every respect of his life. A real leader never obstructs others' freedom. Rather, he teaches how one should enjoy freedom properly, even in the field of action. In another letter, he wrote, the causes of friction and frictions in the monastery or any other organization are, the first thing is anger, second, hatred, third, intolerance for others, mistakes, incompatibility between the mind and the speech, meaning taking the course of untruth and duplicity. And above all, an effort to control the monks through tricks and politics instead of unselfish love. So the causes of friction and frictions in any organization, Swami Sharadananda wrote, the causes for friction is anger, hatred, intolerance for others, mistakes, incompatibility between the mind and the speech, meaning taking course of untruth and duplicity, and above all, an effort to control people under them through tricks and politics instead of unselfish love. This is the cause of trick. If you give this up, then there will be no friction at all. So, wonderful way of handling organization, wonderful way of leadership qualities are being shown by Sharadananda here. So it is really worth studying, and you can research and get so much of clue how to be a good leader. So we'll stop our conversation here, and we will dedicate our time for question and answer. If you have any questions, if you have any doubts, in the YouTube live chat, Sarojini Raju has asked, Jai Ma Pranam Swamiji, won't it cause some sin on the official when Swami Sharadananda touched his shoes to untie the lace? No, because it was done by Sharadananda as a respect to the post of the governor. Ramakrishna used to always tell, a person becomes a king or a governor or goes to the post because of the will of the God. So if you disrespect that person in that post, you are disrespecting the will of the God. So you have to respect every person according to his post and everything that was told by Ramakrishna. Secondly, now that governor is from the Western country. He doesn't know the norms of our Indian customs to treat the monks and the realized souls. So he is doing it unaware. Now, just like the baby now climbs on the head of the father, it kicks the mother with its leg. Will that become a sin? Unknowingly it does that. But when the baby, when it grows up and becomes an elderly person and does that, kicks the mother or the father, that is sinful. But here the Western person, the officer, the British officer, the governor, is unaware of the traditions of the Indian people, the Hindus. And here we should not note the other negative part. We have to note only the humility part of seeing Atman, of seeing God in everybody, and even in that ignorant person, the British officer, the worldly person, the Swami, because he is seeing God. That was the thing which he had asked for. When Ramakrishna had asked him, what boon do you want? He told that I should see God in every living being. And so Sharadananda was seeing God in every living being, and is acting accordingly. So if that person, British officer, had touched the feet with ego, then that would have been sinful. But here, innocently, and he didn't want to, Sharadananda, to remove all those things, but it was Sharadananda himself doing it as a respect to Ramakrishna. He has come to Ramakrishna, so he's showing that respect to Ramakrishna through touching the feet or the shoes of that British official. So it will not be sinful to that person. If done deliberately out of ego, it will be sinful. Unknowingly, innocently, no problem. So any other question here on the Google Live? If you don't have any questions or doubt, I can conclude today's session with a prayer. Om Priyatam Pundarikakshah Sarva Yagneshwaro Harihi. तस्मिन् तुष्टे जगत्तुष्टं प्रीणिते प्रीणितं जगत् हरिः ओम तत्सत् श्रीरामकृष्णार्पणमस्तु। थैंक यू, नमस्ते, ओम नमो नारायणाय।